Gildan Media presents Your Coach in a Box, affordable, life-changing audio programs.
Gildan Audio presents an unabridged recording of Pour Me a Life by A.A. Gill, narrated by Timothy Andres Pabon. 1.
Wake up.
You're at sea. It doesn't matter which sea, it's just the sea, rising and falling. Sea-flavored, sea-shaped, wet sea. You're in a boat, a little boat. You're alone in a little boat. There is nothing else in the boat but you. The boat bobs, you bob. You have no idea how you got here. This at least is not unusual. You woke up in a boat on a sea alone. You look along the horizon. It's as sharp as a razor cut. There's nothing but sea in the cloche of the sky, the salty, bobbing earth curving away. And then there is something just there, there where the sun makes the water flare and shimmy. There are two dots, two things that aren't sea. They're boats. Now there are three boats in the sea. These other boats have a purpose. They have come for you, and that is the nature of these things, these instructive fables. The inner narrator tells you that, though they are coming solely for you, you can stop only one, and to help you choose which, the chorus adds that on the one boat there is a man who will give you food, fresh water, some oars and directions to get to land, and he'll even come with you if you like, but in the other boat there is only a bloke who, if you ask him, will tell you how you got here. So that's the dilemma. Which boat do you stop? We're back in a room in a private mental hospital in the west of England. They call it a treatment center. This is where you can get treatment. Really, it's a mental hospital. We're mental. That's why we need treating. We're dying. Everyone's dying, of course, but we know it. We can taste it, metallic in our sticky, condemned, stumpy mouths. We know we're close to the shuffling end of the coil, and it's our fault. We caused it. We caused it on purpose. We chose the way of our deaths. We can smell it in the damp corruption, our breathless, musty mortality. It lingers in our jackets, on the blankets, in our sad evacuee suitcases. This morning, the doctor holding a file said, "Have you stopped drinking?" "Yes," I said. "Are you sure?" he said, giving me the look of non-judgmental disbelief that is the facial uniform of mental treatment. "Yes," I said. "Yes." And we say yes a lot. It doesn't mean yes. It means stop asking me questions. "Yes?" "Good, because I've got your tests back. And if you go on, you probably won't see Christmas." I'm 30. Outside the window, there is the sea of green lawn with croquet hoops rolling down past trees. I remember them as cedars, huge and lost, standing outside this white, classically country house. How easily the architecture of the aristocracy lends its aspirations to the infirm and the insane. Perhaps I've imported cedars. Maybe they're from some other rolling lawn. I get lawns confused. Lawns just lie there with a permanent ennui, a sickly languor. I wonder what the rest of nature makes of a lawn. Arrogant, snobbish, entitled, needy. Effortfully polite, sober, rebuke of the wild. We're here because we're dying. Death presses up against the broken mirror. Death stands in the corner of the bedroom, signals from the blood in the bog, the pus in the sock, the tingling in the fingers. It wasn't death that terrified us into this preposterously genteel bedlam with its contrite, normal lawn. It isn't the winnowing flail of mortality that grabbed us by the scruff and dragged us all here. Understand this. It's not death that terrifies. It's life. Life is the horror, the unbearable living. We are suffering from life trauma, the miserable, shambling, boring, self-pitying lives we have fashioned for ourselves alone, with shaking hands and a tearful despair. So which boat would you stop? The counselor is a young man, a knowing, public school, compassionate man. I try to imagine his life, but can't. Why would you be here if you weren't mad or carrying the dead weight of a chronic life? Why frolic in the bleak mare of others' troubles, posing as a new life salesman? We listen to him not because he talks compassion or sense, but because he's plainly the captain of the boat, with the stuff, the gear. We are the people who have run out of choices, run through choices and chances, second chances, last chances, simple choices, choices that were no choice at all, always wrong, all desperate, always hopeful. Every cast of the bones was a loser. So here's the choice to finally give up on choice, the chance at the far end of choices. There is an infinitesimal lightening in the room, like the blowing away of a paper hat, and we choose all together unanimously. We look at the man with his life so sordid he can spare the time to sell us a new one, and we feel ourselves bobbing at sea on a lawn, and we shout in our sour salt tight mouths, "Throw us a line, give us an oar, tow us to the furthest shore, to the new land where we can be whole. Take us where we can wash away this life that we made with the sweat of our face, relieve us of the dead burden." This is choice theory. It's a real thing. It was thought up by an American, a psychiatrist called William Glasser, who worked in a veterans hospital in Los Angeles in the 60s. He got fed up with listening to people whine about their lives and regress through their sadness to find the germ of misery in some childish darkness. He decided that what you do is more important than what you did. You don't have to scrabble about in a cellar of nostalgia to discover the seed of your madness. Just get on with now. Do the practical stuff. Make your bed. Make a list. Brush your teeth. Brush your shoes. Mind your manners. Tell a truth. Get up, sit up, stand up, own up. Call your mother. If your feet point one way, your head can't face the other. They tell us that a lot. This thing is also called control theory and reality therapy and cognitive behavioral therapy. It's a fireman's therapy, a 911 therapy. It's an axe and a ladder, a chance for people who are dying faster than they can talk, who don't have the time or the honesty or the inclination or the words, who don't need any more drugs. It's a cut to the cure therapy. If you behave like a normal 9-to-5 guy, then sooner or later you turn into one. Fake it to make it, they say. Fake it to make it. You don't even have to believe. Fake it to make it is a particularly adroit one-size therapy for drunks and junkies, because we're already pretty good at faking stuff, and we need things to happen pretty pronto. We need a hit. We're not feeling great at the moment. Bill Glasser also believed that there were 5 things that people needed in order to function properly, and the first and greatest of these was love. It wasn't an original thought. But they don't tell us this, because frankly, no one wants to be told that the answer to everything is love. No one wants the payoff of his tragedy to be the chorus of a pop song. The night after the last chance choice, I lie in the dark of a dormitory. There are 6 or 7 of us. No one can sleep. I don't mind sharing a room. I've been to a boarding school, but the others, the hard boys with scars, they hate it and rant at the propinquity, rage against intimacy. We can't sleep because we're frightened of the dark, of sleeping, of crying out, of blurting, of wetting ourselves, of dreaming. We lie in the cold sweat with the stinking shroud blankets pulled over our faces and feel the self-pity pour into our mouths until we're drowning in regret, and we gasp in panic and in turn tell one another war stories, our voices like distant radios. There's this boy in his early 20s. He's tall, but he moves like an old, old man, painfully mistrusting gravity. He's covered in psoriasis and bubbling sores. His nose is bust, and his teeth are gone. His body is very close to worn dead. I watched him pack himself into the bed with the slow gentleness of a curator storing ancient porcelain. He has a thick Midlands accent, which I won't be attempting here. I live rough. I've lived rough since I was 16. My dad was drunk. My mom didn't like me. I beg and steal for gear. I live in a multi-story car park in Birmingham. "Why?" a voice asks from the dark. "Why do you live in a pissy car park? You're a fucking tramp. You can go anywhere. That's the only thing to be said for being a tramp. Oh, yes, the flat vowels answer. I've got a place in the country as well. A telephone box outside Sutton Coldfield for the weekends. And we start laughing. Laughing and laughing and laughing with great wheezing guffaws. Laughter that bounces and tumbles off the ceiling and jumps on the beds, billowing the blankets. The noisy, lumpy, hilarious breath runs through me like a great brightness. Magical, free laughter that spins me back to being a child. A hiccuping, chorus-rolling, crashing, howling, sobbing laughter. So unexpected, so strange, like finding that all together we can sing. The tears swim down my cheeks and soak the pillow. Every time the wave recedes, someone catches it, pulling us back, sighing outside Sutton Coldfield, not wanting to lose this moment, this marvelous noise. The black dormitory is raucous with small boys who had all their choices ahead of them. That was the moment I knew I had a chance. 27 years later, I realized that I stopped the wrong boat. My first wife left me in the middle of a dinner party. I can't remember what I said or what she said. I don't remember a row or a diagnosis of inoperable discontent. I don't think anything was thrown. And I don't know who else was there. Not a single face or name comes back to me, though I remember the detritus, the stained glasses, collapsed napkins, the stricken Stilton, the evidence of a room full of people that remained for weeks, like a crime scene or a Spanish still life, a memento mori, the corruption of earthly vanity and fleshly lust. I do remember that we served three sorts of eggs. Goose, duck, and quail. Why would we offer three eggs? Four if you count a hen's egg in the mayonnaise. Who did we think we were becoming? Offering up dinner parties with napery and Stiltons. It was like charades in the bunker. I suppose, along with goose eggs, it was a sort of married life manquet we hoped we might cobble together out of stuff and things and expectations. Out of orphaned china cups and potpourri and Golan's hardbacks with bacon bookmarks, old bald velvet and sepia erotica, Charles Trenet and Wallace Stevens, and cut flowers out of season in arts and crafts vases with broken handles, and portrait gallery postcards on a Welsh dresser. Did we actually own a Welsh dresser? And the willful extravagance of a tissue paper basement bohemianism. It was never really us. We were us once. We had been very us, but the life we made out of each other wasn't. So she left, because there wasn't anything worth staying for, and no prospect of anything worth having or becoming. I knew what she meant. I had every sympathy. If I could have gone with her, I would have. Left the marriage behind with the washing up. Left it to wilt in the vase, fester with the cheese, watched over by the judgmental, curling faces of Christopher Isherwood and Lady Ottoline Morell. This story, this memoir, falls between these two events, the three eggs and the phone box outside Sutton Coldfield. It is the year between the end of the marriage and the end of drinking. I say it's a year, but I have no reliable chronology. It might be only 6 months or 18. It is the space between two ends, each looking the other way. To call it a memoir is to imply memory, a veracity, a recall that I couldn't, can't put my hands on. None of this is hand-on-the-Bible fact. The one miserly charity of drink is that it strips away memory. You start by forgetting the last hour of Saturday night, a name, a conversation, how you lost your shoes. And then, as the life begins to tumble like an upended skier, so the avalanche of forgetting comes and sweeps up the evidence, burying the remembrance in a soft white darkness, a roaring silence. After time, you've forgotten more than you can remember. For me, out of a decade, I have perhaps 2 years, perhaps three, of remembrances. Not consecutive, not related or correlated, just images, like fragments from sagas found stuffed in a mattress, torn photographs on rubbish heaps, strips of wallpaper painted over that make you wonder at the life that once flourished in your bedroom. There is a hope, if not a reliable fact, that this is the best I can muster. This is a retrospective truth gleaned from the shards and tesserae, an attempt to reimagine something lost, an emotional archaeology sifting through the midden for a bone, a coin, a few words scrawled on a flyleaf, my darling, will you, ... an earring in a dinner jacket pocket. Without tools or skill, scheme or expectation, this is an attempt to reconstruct, resurrect the boat that was going the other way and its cargo, its log of how I got here. Because frankly, the choices thing doesn't work the way it used to. Choices beget choices like an infection. I have been sober longer than I was drunk. Every day I choose not to drink is now no harder than choosing to wear my shoes on the prescribed feet and having my face point over my toes. It's not the all or the enough. It's not the answer. I am now closer to my last breath than I am to my last drink, and I need to know. But let's get one thing straight. This is no faith-infused pulpit tale of redemption. This isn't going to be my debauched drink and drug hell. There will be no lessons to learn, no experience to share. There won't be handy hints, lists, golden rules. You will find no encouragement for those who still stagger. I'm not shifting through this soggy tangle of a shredded life for your benefit. I have no message, no help. This isn't an audiobook to give to your sister whose son is having too good a time, or the friend who struggles with his cravings like a randy fat girl squealing, "No, no, no," as her hand shimmies up your shirt. I met my wife in the Lindsay Club, a busted sign above a door that opened into a thin, peely corridor. Under a pale bulb sat Renee, old, apparently made by workhouse orphans out of parchment, tannin-stained calico, and chicken bones. She was a wisp of a woman who was sustained by cold tea and custard creams. She spoke in a genteel voice that sounded like the responses at Evensong. If she recognized you, she would give you a cloakroom ticket for 50 pence, and you could go on down the stairs. Renee would spend her day comforting and confronting the drunk, the deranged, and the damned. She was the most effective bouncer I've ever seen, so delicate and antique, so plainly breakable, that not even the most pugnaciously hammered thug would consider taking it to the mat. I've watched men grab their own collars and eject themselves, screaming that they would go quietly rather than risk chipping Renee. Murderers would come back the morning after some psychotic outburst, blinking back tears, begging forgiveness, and she would be as stern as a remembrance wreath. Downstairs there was a bald, half-sized pool table on a tilt, an ancient jukebox that I only remember playing Sinatra crooning My Kind of Town, a short bar and a mismatched collection of tables and chairs. There were yellow lights with red shades like flung knickers, and a carpet that had the texture of warm tar. The place was coated with nicotine and despair. It was the most hopelessly sad and lonely room I've ever known. There were glazed windows with curtains, behind which was painted a home county's landscape, a wry trompe-l'oeil that twisted the truth. We were in a cellar, a burrow, a tomb where the wounded, sodden, failed and frightened came to hide. On the wall there was a reproduction of a painting of 18th-century huntsmen enjoying a tale, and a tincture in some amicable country hostelry. They were the bucolic English yeomen of yore, ruddy and true, loyal, jolly, prosperous, and sturdy. The picture was a slap, a caution, a reminder of how far from the ideal of manhood and society I had fallen. All the coy, sentimental attempts to cheer up the bar, tranquilize it with kitsch, the plastic flamenco dancers and china poodles, became the malevolent props of a horror movie. You handed your ticket to Peggy behind the bar. Peggy was the opposite of Renee. Whatever it was that Renee hadn't eaten for the past 50 years, Peggy had. She was a gargantuan woman, comically, cartoonishly fat. her body apparently made from a series of boiled puddings piled precariously, sagging and falling over one another. She was always reluctant to disturb the distribution of her bulk once it had settled. She would arrange herself over a stool behind the bar and dispense the drinks she could reach, slowly, inexpertly, and with prejudice. If forced to maneuver for a particularly unlikely order, a sweet sherry, perhaps, or something non-alcoholic, she would breathe deeply through her nose, purse her carmine bow-shaped lips, fix her eye on the object to be retrieved, and tense with the effort of propulsion. For a long moment, nothing would happen, and then, like a landslide, a bit here and a bit there, she would begin to topple in different directions. Her head would settle like a gyroscope, an arm would wave for balance, and like an elephant crossing Niagara Falls on a unicycle, she would oscillate back and forth, making surprisingly elegant progress until the bottle was reached, and she could retrace her trip backward until the safety of the stool would nestle, then gently disappear up her arse. In the center of Peggy's pale, fleshy, suet pudding head was a face of great sweetness and jollity. She had an infectious, rollicking laugh, and a sense of humor whose coarseness transcended its packaging. Above ground in the daylight, Peggy had been an actress, and most memorably the voice of Weed in Flowerpot Men, a children's TV puppet show that began in the 50s. Weed's role consisted of saying, "Weed," with a high-pitched voice in the manner of a daisy. The third member of the Lindsay staff was Rita, who owned the club. She was also ancient, with a bony, sallow, disapproving face and severely neat hair. Rita was permanently disapproving. She despised her customers as failed, pathetic specimens. She didn't have much time for men if they didn't come with titles or horsewhips. Rita told me I should do better for myself than sit and drink in the Lindsay. She was really the least likely person to run a shabby, subterranean drinking club. But then, the Lindsay hadn't always been like this. It, too, had a past, had aspirations. Once it was a theater club, a soiree stage for amateur and professional rising talent. The young Dirk Bogarde had played the Lindsay. The yellowing poster was here to prove it, but as angry young men and a new realism and swearing claimed the stage, so the Lindsay withered, its bright jollity declining until only the bar remained solvent, and Rita and Renee and Peggy were set adrift in it, like a lifeboat coming to rest here, breached and broken on this reef of disappointing men. I loved it. I loved it because it was so perfectly tailored to me, a room I could look in the eye and know that it loved me right back. In exchange for the cloakroom ticket, Peggy would give you a sausage. The Lindsay existed in the crevices of the licensing laws. To drink, you had to eat, and because it was notionally a club, it could serve drink outside opening hours. The Lindsay only really existed between 3 in the afternoon and 5:30, and then from 11 p.m. till midnight, which would stretch to 1 a.m. It was for those for whom the license day was not long enough to fit in the required pintage, for those of us who did alcohol overtime. The drink might kill you, but nobody risked eating the sausage. It went to my dog, Lily, a lecherly mongrel who lived under benches and on sausages. Always ahead of me after closing time at the Elephant and Castle up the road was Alex Troche, the Scottish novelist and lifelong junkie. Alex, granite-faced, angry iconoclast, fearless nihilist, rager against the night, had managed to make heroin seem parochial, rather bourgeois. He'd done it for so long that it had become a pomade, a tonic. It never seemed to make any difference to his demeanor. I never saw him gouch or get scratchy. He had a small antiquarian book business and a massive, immovable writer's block. Sometimes he'd buy my paintings. We'd sit in corners, him reading fast, a solace and a distraction, and I imagine a torture, often with Kit Lambert, son of the composer Constant Lambert, and manager of The Who. Kit had had a palazzo in Venice, which he lost or set fire to. He lost everything, including most of the things he tried to put in his mouth. The front of him looked like an abandoned gannet colony. Kit had been arrested for drugs and was convinced that his best defense was to make himself a ward of the court, so that the official solicitor gave him pocket money out of his own considerable royalties. Kit looked like a furious French bulldog. He had a voice that sounded like someone continuously trying to start a lawnmower, and he was clownishly clumsy. He could clear a table simply by looking at his watch. It was also immensely funny and clever and cultured when he wasn't incoherently drunk. He had an incandescent temper, and if I ever told him to stop setting fire to my clothes or tipping beer into my lap, he'd shout at the top of his mechanical voice, "Oh, nanny, 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 Gill, fuck off." His life had shrunk to a single Herculean tantrum at the parsimony of his executors. The madder he got, the more parsimonious they became. He would conceive even more absurd ruses to get his money back. He died after being in a fight in a gay club and then falling down his mother's stairs. Alex died of pneumonia 3 years later. I still have a copy of his Keynes book, inscribed "To Lily, instead of a sausage." The rest of the Lindsay's customers were art students, diplomatic protection officers, one of whom once pulled his gun on me, mean little criminals, actors, Montenegrin jean salesmen, and Kensington's decrepit and fallen gentry, men with stinking blazers and burst veins, women who had compacts and cigarette holders and who wet themselves on bar stools, and, I seem to remember, a statistically significant number of men with non-specific wounds. I was sitting under the window, looking out over the home countries reading The Standard, and a girl standing at the bar slid in opposite me. I'd noticed her because the room was small and there were so few strangers. She was gaming and preternaturally vivacious for the Lindsay. She wore corduroy shorts, lisle tights, and a hand-me-down Fair Isle cardigan. She had clever eyes that dodged behind a faded fringe. She said I looked sad. I told her that the girl I was in love with was in New York, and I couldn't afford to go to New York, and she couldn't be here, so I was sad. She agreed that that was sad, pulled a large, glittering ring off her finger, and pushed it across the table. "Take this. I'm sure it's worth a ticket to New York." "No, really. You must take it. Go now. Go today." It was my great aunt's engagement ring. She was marvelous, had masses of lovers, and would simply insist you take it. What on earth are engagement rings for if not to bring lovers together? I said I couldn't possibly, but it was incredibly, brilliantly kind of her, and it had stopped me from feeling sad, and at least I could buy her a drink. "I don't even know your name," I said. "I'm Cressida Connolly," she said, sticking out her hand and cocking her head to one side with a grin that was half warm, half defensive, and that I would come to know well. "Well, I know who you are," she said. 6 months later, maybe 12, she tapped the shoulder of a man in a queue at a baker's and said, "I'm going to marry your son." The man looked askance and replied, "We've never met. How do you know who I am or that I even have a son?" And Cressida cocked her head and grinned, "You could only be Adrian's father." A few months after that, or maybe weeks, I was lying in a morning bath, and she brought me an orphan cup of warm milk and brandy and said, "You know, if we get married, I'll always make sure there's beer in the fridge." Romantically, we peaked too soon. Two. The DTs, delirium tremens, medical Latin for shaking frenzy. They seem to have gone the way of gothic fainting, female genital hysteria, and poor nerves. They are pre-national health, a quaint black and white starched wimple rectal thermometer condition. DTs belong to a nostalgic type of inebriation, along with whiskey bottles with corks, horse-drawn drays, and pink gin. At a summer of pink gins, drunk as personal self-flagellatory punishment because I was drinking too much, I imagined I'd drink less if the drink was vile. Indeed, they were so gratuitously foul, I had to neck the first two at a dead sprint, after which I'd pass caring what they tasted like. The barman always asked, "In or out? Do you want the bitters left or flicked?" leaving the gin pale, pink-tinctured. DTs went the way of drunk tanks, straitjackets, padded rooms, and music hall drinks. There aren't comedy drunks anymore. They used to be clowns whose acts were slapstick tipsy, stand-up-and-fall-down comedians with semi-detached collars, squiffy ties, and a broken fag. It was funnier if it was a toff, the descent more precipitous and humiliating, unrestrained by a safety net of sympathy. A flat-cap drunk was a Methodist sermon and a crusade, not a thing of humor. But the posh pissed are ripe for mockery. The slow mime of misjudgment, the lost keys, the wife in bed with the gamekeeper, top-hatted johnnies throwing pebbles at lampposts because there's a light on upstairs. When did we stop thinking all that was amusing? Why did we stop laughing at drunks? They were such a staple character of John bullying British humor. Before the Roman came to Rye or out to Severn Strode, the rolling English drunkard made the rolling English road. The nations of Britain were collated by drink long before they were collected under one crown or church. The brown baritone Welsh drunks, the lyrical Irish drunks, the morose Scots, and the tedious English. Boorish, finger-jabby, jut-chin drunks, all of them. Nations that are heavy and mild, light and bitter, gin-soaked, whiskey-steeped, cider-soused. Every so often, some why-oh-why politician will ask, why-oh-why can't the British drink like the Continentals, like the Southern Europeans? The question is rhetorical, inspired by the memory of agreeable afternoons spent in the staccatoed buzz of Tuscan villas or provincial village squares, listening to the plink-plink of petanque and the drone of fat Englishmen in straw hats. No one ever asks drunks in the dank corners of urban pubs why they drink like dank drunks in dark corners instead of like happy dagos in the sunshine. So we never hear the rhetorical answer, fruity with phlegm and sprayed crisp crumbs. We drink like this because we can, because it's our birthright, it's our heritage, our history, our myth and legend. Why would you drink like a prissy, prancing, mellifluous child of Dionysus in the vineyards of antiquity when you could bellow obscene songs in the mead halls of Asgard? We are the chilly, sweaty drunks of the north, of the long nights. We drink in the dark, in the flickering shadows, not in the sunny blue-hued shade of the south. We drink like this because we fucking can. It was the medical Latin that killed the humor of drunks, when they designated alcoholism an illness rather than a weakness or a choice or a culture. That's when it became mocking the disabled. You can't laugh at an illness, an ism, unless you're pissed. But then, I never had much time for theatrical lushes. Drink was my craft. I took a professional pride, and comedians and clowns always got it wrong. The actor is a sober man pretending to be a drunk. A drunk is an inebriated man desperately trying to look sober. Watch the precision, the concentration of the shit-faced attempting to get across a room. It is a heroic effort. Inside that wobbling head, he is the captain of a doomed bomber, struggling with the unresponsive controls, staying at his post till the last, after everyone else has evacuated. Bowels, bladder, syntax, the world spins, the ground rushes up to claim him, yet still he fights for every inch of height, every ounce of propulsion. David Niven in the cockpit of his flaming lank, talking to the ethereal, invisible, cool and admiring WAAF. Maybe he can make it to the door, to bed, to some glorious country airfield where the dog's waiting to meet him. There's a pat on the back from the CO. Damn close run thing. And into the mess, barmaid already has the foaming tankard with the double stiffener on the side. She's smiling, trying to hide the tears. He leans on the bar, a pensive sigh, and slowly lifts the glass. Here's to those who didn't make it. We do good crash landings. Watch the face, the determination, the perseverance, the pursed lips, the knotted brow, the head swaying, running out of energy, feet numb on a tightrope, one stalwart leg, the other a coward. You shouldn't mock the crumpled failure of drunks, but wonder instead at the repeated, determined, hopeless bravery of so many postponed calamities mentioned only in imaginary slurred dispatches. I can't remember what our bedroom looked like. The flat was the basement of a terraced house in Wandsworth, Bennerly Road. I can't remember the number. A living room, a bedroom, a bathroom, a kitchen, and the small garden we shared with Chris, the landlord upstairs. I remember the kitchen. Small like a galley with a back door onto the ignored garden. A no man's land of dead pheasants, sodden barbecue, and more dog shit. There was a Welsh dresser, an oven, a sink, a table pushed up against a wall. I can't remember the chairs or if there was anything on the walls or the tea towels, which is odd. You can always remember tea towels. Were they white or colored? Did they have ironic pictures on them of seaside towns and recipes for regional specialties? There was a radio, and the radio was always on, always, no exception, on in every room. I couldn't sleep without a radio, the BBC World Service at night, Lillibullero, played by the RAF band, the shipping forecast, London Calling. Then Radio 4 would start in the dawn, farming today, beef prices, wheat yields. After a fitful night of African politicians, the radio was like a parent. I was brought up by the home service. It was moral and dependable, and it had a plan. It knew where I would be at any given hours. It had rules. I understand why home service listeners get so upset when schedules change. I get upset. Everything else in life is random and collapsing, fateful and a disappointment. But the radio is a fixed point, something you can't grasp, but you can hold on to. The bedroom had a window. There must have been a wardrobe, a chest of drawers, a mirror somewhere, something on the walls. What color were the walls? The carpet was green. There was a green carpet, the color of algae, the damp green of penicillin. I remember how it smelled. It was like a living thing, the pelt of something that hid terrified and shivering under the furniture and basements. The bed was big, with an ornate headboard carved with herms or caryatids, cherubs, griffins, basilisks, cockatrices, black oak nightmares. It was a Cromwellian bed for morbid lingering, a laying-out bed, already half a coffin. I don't remember the counterpane or the blankets, quilts, or pillows. I remember how it smelled. It smelled like it had been having rough, non-consensual sex with the carpet, the sour, sweet sweat of the sorry, mold-green, abused carpet. You can't get any lower than a basement carpet. It was in the bed that the DTs came. One morning, I woke up. Waking up is not a given for a drunk. It's not a simple transition. It's not how you wake up, like turning the key in the ignition, a couple of coughs, and you're ticking over in neutral. A drunk's awakening has layers and protocols. There's a great deal of spare and lonely emotion that has to be acknowledged, folded up and buried between sleep and consciousness. There's the panic of unresolved fright left over from the badlands of sleep. Every drunk has a procedure for getting things locked back and away in their crypts and cages. I was gingerly negotiating the painful roundup when there, just there, right there on the ceiling, there were spiders, spiders hanging on to the ceiling. They were off the reservation, out of the box. They weren't the shades of night. They were huge, the size of soup plates, heavy as gilt. They scuttled. No, spiders don't scuttle. They move with a horrible purpose. Spiders octorate. They are always on a mission. These ones octorated across the ceiling from behind the wardrobe that may or may not have been there. They were hairy, and I knew they were going to fall on my face. They were bigger than my head. Simultaneously, I also knew empirically, practically, that spiders bigger than your head were not indigenous to Wandsworth. So, sensibly, like a 5-year-old, I closed my eyes tight and waited for them to go away or get back inside wherever it was monstrous, impossible creatures lived. I've had a lot of hallucinations in my time, from acid before it was moderated and pasteurized into an easy psychotropic disco drug, when an LSD workout lasted a day and came with added flashbacks that would slap your retina a month later. We would advise each other not to drop tabs alone. A trip was a dangerous saga. I'd seen the wallpaper turn into an Earth Mother's pulsating womb. I'd seen vacuum cleaners become Jack's beanstalk. I'd stared into a sugar bowl for 5 hours, downloading the secrets of kinetic sweet energy. I'd watched the traffic on Tottenham Court Road turn into a carousel. I knew all about hallucination, and these spiders weren't hallucination. I got out of bed in a cold panic of twisted sheets and palsied limbs. The spiders came after me. The brilliance of delirium is that it happens only when you're sober. You can't blame it on the port or the absinthe. I was straight up, single-visioned, unslurred, unprotected, and utterly unprepared. The trick, the cure, the prophylactic, is to get drunk again as quickly as possible. I understood this instinctively, but then the answer to most things was to get drunk or drunker. I sucked a whiskey bottle in a corner, not daring to look up. It wasn't the first time I'd drunk to make things go away, but it was the only time it worked. A doctor tells me that the rarity of DTs in modern drunks is because alcoholics get help, or at least medication, much earlier these days. They are given Valium, a really simple cure for the horrors. Not actually a cure, of course, just a muzzle. It pulls the curtains and keeps the spiders on the reservation. Before Valium, DTs were a favorite image for filmmakers. Billy Wilder's The Lost Weekend has a rubber bat that eats an imaginary rat. There is something crawly in Blake Edwards's Days of Wine and Roses. Charles Lofton, in David Lean's Hobson's Choice, gets a giant rat at the end of his bed. And then there's Harvey, the urban rabbit in James Stewart's hallucination. I think that's the only case of a hallucination from a chronic illness getting its name up in lights, and not just imaginary ones. Drunks' horror visions are almost always animals. A small medieval menagerie of the repellent and fearful, things that share our homes, under the floorboards, in the rafters. They can come with a tactile hallucination technically known as formication. You feel things crawling all over you. 3D scents surround hallucination. There was a publican in Earl's Court who regularly saw Martian cockroaches landing outside his pub and would block the road with beer barrels for the safety of humans. I've only ever heard of one man who had a pleasant, though no less disturbing, hallucination. Having drunk a concoction based on bomb fuel during national service in Malaya, he was hospitalized and woke to find a naked Malay girl sitting on the end of his bed. She gave him a medical discharge. The shaking frenzy DTs were first described in 1813. Between 5% and 10% of drunks get them. Of those, 35% die shortly after. Surprisingly, there's very little research into the DTs, considering how much has been painstakingly discovered about Amazonian frogs and the causes of baldness. No one knows why they happen or how, but the lack of scientific interest is understandable, if not excusable. DTs are merely a curious symptom of an altogether familiar chronic condition. The Valium will smudge the visions, and they make no difference to the underlying illness. They are a strange illumination that may have something to do with GABA receptors and the greed for dopamine and the serotonin of joy, the well-being chemicals that are the usual suspects implicated in addiction. Someone has suggested that the DTs may be the result of the brain's attempting to reinstate homeostasis. The body needs to maintain equilibrium, a stable internal environment, to correct its psychic balance, to combat the constant intervention of alcohol. That doesn't sound plausible. The latest hypothesis, I'm told, is that DTs are something to do with scratches on the retina and the exaggerated or altered focus, which sounds even less plausible. Why is it that drunks should all find these prehistoric animal familiars, see the creatures of caves and stones, of cracks and holes? Are they perhaps found in the unvisited blackness of our mental archaeology, down beneath the conscious and the subconscious, down, down past the mysterious id into the layers of natural selection, the millefeuille of experience pressed hard in the fossil of collective memory, this scuttling, slithering, ossified fear? There is no truth in alcohol, but it may wear away and seep down into the remembrance of things that are best left unrehydrated. DTs were the most dramatic of my alcohol-induced symptoms, but I got them only twice. The second time, my conscience knew what was happening. I woke to find a fat toad watching me with its peculiarly evil eyes like a malevolent Eccles cake on the slime-green algae, dead-raped carpet. I got out of bed and poked the phantasm with my toe. It stepped aside, slowly, theatrically. It was a real fucking toad. God knows how it had got in. It must have traveled across Wandsworth to find a sympathetic environment. Toads are notoriously choosy. I had a bedroom that was an ideal toad habitat, and getting rid of a live toad is far harder than getting rid of a hallucinatory one, but for a drunk, the method is the same. I got a bottle of whiskey and trusted that it would get bored and go away. I picked up a pigeon in the street once. The pigeon had been hit by a car. It was alive, not noticeably damaged or bleeding, so I put it in my pocket. A pigeon will fit quite neatly into a jacket pocket. I went to the pub and forgot about it, then on to the Lindsay Club. The next day I was looking for cigarettes, and there was the pigeon, head cocked, round-eyed, blinking. I was surprised to find it in the coat dropped on the floor, incubating 5 gitanes. Pockets were a constant source of surprise. A lamb chop, a votive candle, earrings, lockless keys, a photograph of an old man with a mustache and a harmonium, scribbled phone numbers, addresses in cards, notes written on paper ripped from books and menus. Don't ring the bell. This is the last time. You owe me 5, crossed out. 15, crossed out. 20. The bone of an ice lolly with a strawberry dampness. Morning pockets were like tiny crime scenes. And then there was the pigeon. I put it on the bed with the dog. They stared at each other. I threw a slice of bread on the bed. The dog ate it. I put another under the pillow, expecting the pigeon to find it. The pigeon lived on the bed for days. I don't know, maybe weeks. The dog on one side, the pigeon on the other, me in the middle. It didn't move much, just crapped a little. Didn't seem to get any better or any worse. Never complained or asked for anything. A girl came over, this was after Cressida left, and complained about having to sleep with a pigeon. I said I'd sleep next to the pigeon and it wouldn't.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.